Thanks. On creativity and the arts, first of all of us are really excited that this is included in the program. I mean, sometimes art is not given the attention it deserves in our society, and we all think art and artistic practice is very important to American society. I mean, the art that we create exposes our deepest feelings about what's going on around us, and it often is what stands the test of time. Future generations will judge what we are often by what we create and make. And another important aspect of art, which is underappreciated, is just the importance of learning artistic practices and creative practices. Artists tend to use all sorts of interesting techniques to enhance creativity, and creativity really fuels innovation and inventiveness, which is important in all aspects of what we do, not just, so even if you're not an artist, artistic training and practice can be very, very helpful to you. So in this panel, we've decided to focus on three themes. The first is the development of new tools for art and design. Now, as many of you know, over the last couple decades, almost all of analog media has switched to digital media. It started with desktop publishing and the sort of the laser printer. It's expanded into digital photography. Probably everybody in this room now has a digital camera, which has replaced film cameras. And even as I speak, HD TV is replacing analog television. Television stations are literally shutting down their analog broadcasts. But even more interesting is the development of new media technologies, things like gaming, virtual worlds, and in fact, the way movie production has changed with new tools. So that'll be one topic we'll cover. The other one we all feel very passionate about is the democratization of craft and art, not just fine arts, but the crafts that everyday citizens make, from fabric art to various types of toys, musical instruments, and so on. And so we'll talk about how information technology has enhanced the development of craft throughout the United States, particularly in the last few years. And then the final point we'll cover is how ideas from computing have changed the way visual artists, musicians, movie makers, and others think of art itself and the artistic process. So we have a very diverse panel. We have a musician, a filmmaker, a publisher, and one of the great entrepreneurs of our country on the panel. Starting with Jonathan Berger, he is the professor of music at Stanford University. He's also the co-director of the Stanford Institute for Creativity and the Arts and a faculty member of the Center for Computer Research in Music and Acoustics, CARMA, which is one of the leading centers for computer music research. He's also an accomplished composer and an active researcher himself. Next, we have Dale Doherty. He is the founding editor and publisher of Make and Craft magazines, both of which focus on do-it-yourself projects, and the creator of the Maker Fair, which showcases creative communities. Many of you may have gone to the Maker Fair last couple years. I went last year with 65,000 other fanatics. It was quite an experience. We also have Chuck Geschke, who is co-chairman of the board and former president and chief operating officer of Adobe Systems, which he co-founded in 1982 with John Warnock, who's also in the audience and who will be speaking tomorrow. Adobe builds basically all the tools that we use every day when doing graphic design, art, music, video production. And so his company has had a tremendous impact on our society. And finally, Carl Rosendahl, who founded Pacific Data Images in 1980. I met Carl around that time. I remember the first time I met him, he showed me a portfolio of computer-generated spaceships that he had just produced. And he started this company to combine his passions for filmmaking and technology. PDI was really one of the first companies to focus on digital filmmaking, and now it is a division of DreamWorks. They produce the films Ants and Shrek, both, I'm sure, of which you've heard. So with that, I'll turn it over to the panelists. We'll start with Chuck.
Well, thank you, Pat, for the kind introduction, and thanks to the Academy for organizing this discussion this afternoon. I think it's one that should be very interesting to you as an audience and as Pat already mentioned, important to our society, since not everyone in the world, surprise, surprise, is left-brained oriented. There are a few right-brainers in the world, and a few people who are lucky enough to have a little bit of both. I'm going to do something a little different than actually Pat mentioned. I hope it doesn't shock him too much. But I want to talk about sort of the evolution of the technologies that got us to the point where we are. Part of the overall charge here was to see what good things have been contributed to our society by the technological revolution we've seen over the last several decades. And as we discussed earlier this morning, particularly in the case of newspapers and book publishing and other things, there's a possibility that that technology has unleashed something that we didn't expect that could be viewed as something not so positive, depending upon how it evolves. I'll make this very brief because I know you want to see the demonstration of some of the technologies that are going to be shared with you in a few minutes. But I'm going to examine just very briefly the history of how we got to the point of starting this transformation of the communication arts from an analog world to the digital world, and look at sort of three very quick case studies: desktop publishing, digital photography, and what was always and still is, although it's becoming realized now, the holy grail of a paperless world. I'll start in the 60s. When ARPA was founded, it was actually started by John Kennedy with the encouragement of Dwight Eisenhower as the handover was happening for leadership of the government. And the original objective was that ARPA was to focus on research that would help particularly the Defense Department move from analog communications to digital communications. I suspect the two gentlemen who, one past president and one new president, probably didn't know what that meant, but they fortunately picked some great people. And as a result, the ARPA department was formed inside DOD. Probably a majority of the technical people in this room are either ARPA brats or ARPA contractors. Certainly I'm one. My partner John Warnock is one as well. And that did a tremendous amount to expand the field of computer science, which in fact was not a discipline recognized until the late 60s. Most of the people who are active in computing either came out of mathematics departments, physics departments, electrical engineering. And the world of communication arts, printing world, the photography world, was all analog at that time, and obviously sound as well. Because of ARPA, this new cadre of people came into the marketplace for doing research and development, and Xerox started a research lab in Palo Alto, which many of you I know are familiar with Xerox Park. And they began looking at a whole variety of new ways of thinking about using computers to communicate and to get engaged in the printing process. It was that lab that did some of the seminal work behind the very first high-end laser printer, the Xerox 9700. And there was a lot of work going on in the area of graphics and printing technologies and so forth. When John and I left Xerox, it was to start a company, and we had a business plan that roughly said that we were going to generate all of the software, put together, fabricate the computers, the laser printers, and the, in effect, typesetting equipment, put that all together in one big package and sell it to the Fortune 500 for doing in-house publishing, primarily focused on giving them more control and much lower cost for getting from concept to the printed page. Thank God we never executed that business plan. There were several companies trying to do roughly the same thing. None of them survived for very long. And we had the good fortune of deciding early on to build some strong partnerships with companies like Aldus up in Seattle, who did PageMaker, with Apple Computer, who was just bringing out the Macintosh and about to bring out the LaserWriter, with Canon, who was the company who was actually manufacturing that desktop laser printer, the first really easily deployable laser printer in the industry, and of course a company called Linotype, which was in a leadership position in Europe and owned the trademarks to all of the major typefaces. And the reason for doing that partnerships were pragmatic as well as critical to our positioning ourselves in the industry. As we came at this with the attitude that we had to produce products that were capable of printing that met the standards of the graphic arts world. Anything less than that would never be successful in a broad market adoption. So in some sense, a comment was made earlier this morning, I think by Ed, that we were going to simulate the past and do it at least as well as the past and do it more efficiently and more effectively. Well, with that attitude in mind, we started off to build our company, and having thrown that business plan out and deciding just to focus on the way to drive the laser printers and to partner with those other companies, we eventually brought out the Laser Writer, and it had an incredibly positive impact, not only obviously on our business, but on Apple's business and all of those partners that I've mentioned. The effect of it was that the whole process of print production became much lower cost, got rid of all of the toxic substances that were used in the printing process, pre-press and pre-production process, etching baths, benzene, cyanide, a whole bunch of just awful chemical processes that were used to make printing plates, of which I had some personal experience because both my grandfather and father were letterpress photo engravers, the people who built the copper four-color plates that were used in the printing industry at that time. A very labor-intensive and obviously an analog kind of system. And our goal was to achieve, as I said, the graphic arts quality that industry had already set standards around. So we found very dynamic growth because we were able to reduce the cost of that print production process, and we were able to do something that was more environmentally friendly. As a result, anybody who owned, a Macintosh or a PC and a laser printer had their own printing press. I remember Aldous ran an ad around the time of the turnover in Russia saying that PageMaker had been used to produce the documents that were necessary to get Gorbachev's position advanced in that country. And in 10 years from the start of this whole desktop publishing initiative, which began in 1985, essentially all printing and publishing worldwide had gone completely electronic. In the late 80s, we looked at another potential market because we realized that if you could make the printed page be produced digitally, there's absolutely no reason why any image, whether it's a television image or a photograph, couldn't also be produced digitally. But at the time, there were no digital cameras. If you owned a scanner, it was the size of a refrigerator and it cost you $35,000 to $40,000. If you owned a power machine, a Macintosh with an extra hard drive, it had this little black and white screen, and if you were that power user, you might have had a 20 megabyte disk drive, enough to hold a couple of images in today's more advanced world. Not exactly the environment in which you would come out with a product, but there were two guys in a garage. They weren't in Silicon Valley. They were actually at the University of Michigan, the Knoll brothers, who came by to visit us and showed us this interesting piece of software for editing photographs. We decided to take the plunge. We once again went out to look for partners. The most eager ones were the Japanese camera manufacturers. And the people who should have been interested, Kodak, Agfa, and Fujifilm, because they had this great business already in place, were resistant. And as a result, their business has changed dramatically in the ensuing time. The net result of that was much lower cost. You only print the photographs that you want. In fact, if you're fortunate enough to have a high-quality printer in your house, which today is very affordable, you can print your own photographs. You can distribute them electronically. You can share them online. The whole world of photography changed. Those were the benefits. We'll talk about one of the problems that it brought out as well. By the very late 80s, really the beginning of 1990s, John came up with a really great idea. He said, you know, if we captured the information just at the point it was going to be printed on a PostScript printer and converted it into an electronic form, we'd have a much more efficient way to distribute and share information. You wouldn't have the cost of shipping the paper, of printing it, binding it, inventorying it, throwing out the obsolete inventory, all of those issues, if you just distributed it electronically. And if someone preferred to read it on paper, they would bear the cost of printing. In other words, the recipient would bear that cost. Well, that observation led to the development of a product called Acrobat and the portable document format. We made a decision to introduce that product in 1993, and it didn't do very well. The reason it didn't do very well is there was no infrastructure to achieve the kind of mass distribution that we anticipated. We thought corporations with their local area networks and long-haul communication lines would figure this out, but they didn't. Fortunately, the World Wide Web came along, and today there are billions of documents and maybe trillions of pages out on the World Wide Web, all in this format, all capable of being shared anywhere in the world on any kind of platform, and a tremendous amount of efficiency in reducing costs and changing the dynamics, both cost-wise and environmentally, in terms of how information is distributed, stored, and retrieved. All good news, right? Well, we heard this morning about one piece of bad news, potentially, and that is that if you're in the newspaper or magazine business, you're coming under tremendous stress. Indeed, the technology that was introduced in the 80s reduced the cost of production, but it really hadn't yet taken the ability to change the business model of the people who are in that business. And they look at a revenue model that's predicated on them printing and distributing physical media. And if they were to eliminate doing that, it would be a tremendous loss in revenue, and therefore their entire infrastructure that they've invested in would come under serious difficulties in terms of running that business. So the good news is that there is a much more efficient way to distribute this information today. The bad news is that some of the business models that worked 50 and 60 years ago don't work anymore. And so it's time for those companies to figure out how to transform themselves, and we already had a lot of that discussion earlier today. On the digital photography side, clearly had a major impact on the film manufacturing business. It removed silver halide as a toxic substance that goes into our water supply, but it also caused a great disruption in the business of three major companies, Kodak, Fujifilm, and Agfa. The other piece of bad news is that people believe that now, for the first time, you can't trust a photograph, because with Photoshop, you can change it to whatever you want. I want to let you in on a secret. Ever since the first camera was introduced, you couldn't trust a photograph. It just took a slightly more experienced person in a much less friendly environment, namely a darkroom, to make some of those same kinds of modifications. I'll grant you today, there are many more people who can do that in a very short amount of time without a lot of skill. And I think the final comment about the paperless world is, what does it mean not only for newspapers and magazines, but as I know we're going to discuss tomorrow, what does it mean about the future of the book? You know, my youngest son was a law student at Stanford, and I would see him lug this knapsack of books on his back. I'm thinking, God, if he just had a little Mac Air, he could have had the entire library from the law school on that machine. Why lug all that stuff around? Read it electronically. Well, I think the difficulty is that our generation and even my son's generation grew up mostly reading on paper. Fortunately or unfortunately, depending upon what your business is, the next generation is not going to have that problem. They're very used to reading on a machine, if nothing else from searching on the web, and it's highly likely the book in electronic form is really going to make a tremendous impact in that industry. So I'm going to leave this at that. We're going to talk about some interesting other technologies, and I'm turning it over to Dale.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here. This is an artistic statement of sorts on a roadside sign, and I'd kind of like to take it apart. But first, I mean, it's probably a sign that usually says, fish and chips, Friday night, $2.99, you know. But someone has put it outside an office building and said, you know, with utter enthusiasm, all I want to be is someone that makes new things. you know, and then thinks about them and probably makes more things. That, in essence, I think is what I've been trying to capture and reflect and discover through my magazine and through our events here. And you say, well, what do you mean? What is that? Well, this is actually reasonably old. This is Kelly Dobson from MIT. And if you, hopefully sound is up. So it's a voice-activated blender. So, you know, it gets to controlling your environment using some kind of sensor, but it's a kind of interaction design that's happening. People are hacking things today, just as they've been hacking software. This is an example of a pumpkin, hacking a pumpkin to put a speaker in it. Control lights, so when someone walks in the room, it makes noise and flashes. Behind it is a small microcontroller called Arduino, and there's this sort of new kind of open source that's out there being applied to hardware now. So this is actually out of Italy, but you know, you have to buy it because it's got to be manufactured. But the specs are all open, the documentation's open, and it's formed a community of tinkerers that want to do interesting things and control it, you know, with a small computer, but connect it to lots of sensors, lights, and other kinds of things. So I produce a magazine called Make, which I'll come back to in a minute. But it, you know, I kind of want to present today as this sort of bridge between hacking and tinkering, and as an example, this comes from Stephen Levy's book called The Hackers, but Peter Sampson of MIT belonged to the Tech Model Railroad Club. And as Levy describes it, there were two kinds of groups within the group. One worked on the layout, you know, build the tunnels, build the mountains, put the little trees up. The others worked on the switches underneath. And Peter was one of those folks. But, you know, this kind of statement, I think, is what I'm seeing. He had grown up with a specific relationship to the world wherein things had meaning only if you find out how they worked, and how you found out they worked by getting your hands on them, taking them apart, manipulating them. And going back to that original sign, you know, we have tended to separate hands-on and manual work from thinking and mental work. And I think we're seeing a desire to bring it back together. Chairman Tim Brown of IDEO has a phrase called making is thinking, and I think it's pretty consistent out there. But again, is this something new? No, of course not. It's really a part of a tradition, something that's been around a long time. And that's that. When I designed the magazine, I went back and thought, well, is this just something I'm seeing now, that people were hacking TiVos? You know, they're making new things, modding computers, doing all kinds of things. But, you know, you go back, this is from 1944, What to Make, Popular Mechanics. This is Popular Science, 1964, you know. The great thing about these magazines is if there was any new technology idea, they put you in the middle of it. There's no better example than the submersibles. You were going to have a submarine of your own. What a promise. You know, robots, they were going to be all around the house. Well, you know, this kind of led to a set of practices. People were familiar with it. I've interviewed one of the fellows, his father's president of Heathkit. He said, I didn't experience the world of electronics except through a Heathkit catalog. You know, I stayed up night reading it to understand how things worked. And magazines like Popular Mechanics, Popular Electronics told you about it. The first computers, many of them are coming out of kits. This is an early Heathkit model. And so, you know, when I saw this putting together, I designed a magazine to be, this is actually the same trim size as Popular Science was in 1959, same size as Popular Mechanics. It's kind of a digest size that sort of wasn't popular with publishers today. But and I wanted to kind of, you know, capture the recipes, the instructions, the excitement, enthusiasm of this community, and share it in an old-fashioned form in print and in a new-fashioned form online as well. let me tell you a little bit about these things. There is, we call it DIY or do-it-yourself, communities of people doing new kind of crazy things. You've heard of Burning Man and that kind of events like that. But, you know, one of the connections here that I think is really fresh, maybe DIY in Depression era was driven a lot by, as it might be again today, by some practical concerns is how do I save money. A lot of these folks who are using it as a form of personal expression. You know, I'm going to make something, maybe have someone take my picture or put it online, but you get to know someone by what they make. So, like open source, one of the key concepts of open source is to scratch your own itch. There's something inside of you that you want to do, and you do it for that reason first, and the effect of it on other people comes later. But you know, this is a real simple little you know, battery and LED things. People are making all kinds of silly stuff, but you know, communities are organizing around projects and tools and skill sets. Now, you might say, okay, that's simple enough. But you know, maybe in the 50s and prior ages of tinkering, you know, they were organized around your home, usually your parents or your school, your teachers. They were local. You were kind of limited to who you know. So when you ask an engineer today, how did you become an engineer? Good chance that a father or mother or someone in the immediate family or someone else got involved in that, which is a great thing. But we don't necessarily know how to make engineers or make creative people. They come out of a culture of this, and they get a lot of support from things like communities. What's really new today is that, you know, if you have a particular project, you can go online and you can find someone who's doing a similar project and ask them a question, and they may be in Toledo, Ohio, and you're in Mountain View. You know, we can share recipes, we can share our experience with other people online, and it's a very powerful thing. And in other words, you think of blogging, you think of YouTube, and you think, well, people are just creating like entertainments or they're just writing. Well, people are making things and blogging about them or putting videos up about how they made them. It's all part of that participatory culture that we're seeing here today. But there's something more too, and I think it's part of people. This is engaging stuff. You know, what I'm calling a high-res experience, is we have high-res TVs. When you're making something, manipulating it, seeing things in all the dimensions and touching it, working with it, especially with other people, it is a different kind of experience. And I think the thing that we see today is you make something, you share it maybe online or at a fair or something, and you meet other people that are doing it. So it's an entree to a community. It's an entree to a bunch of other people that may be sharing your interests. Ultimately, I think, when I thought of the magazine, is this is a kind of play, a sophisticated form of play. This is a pulse jet organ, which is extremely loud, extremely bright, and it's a very interesting way of making music. just a few thoughts. Eric von Hippel is a Sloan School at MIT, and he's been writing about democratizing innovation. And I think he's made some really interesting points, just so you don't think this is just a bunch of people out on the fringe doing things. He says that users of products and services are increasingly able to innovate for themselves. He's locating innovation in use, not in necessarily large companies coming up with, you know, their R&D department coming up with a brand new thing. He said users don't have to develop everything. They can benefit from sharing. They can find just a niche. And I think that's what we're seeing in open source. People build on layers. They build on top of other people's work. It's certainly what we've seen in science and other things in the past, but it's wide open. His point, like the scratch your itch point, you know, and his models are sometimes recreational sports. Someone's building kayaks, and they want to run a certain kind of rapids. The kayak is too long for that, so they modify the kayak. Other people see that modified kayak and say, where did you get that? And they say, well, I built it myself. And he said, well, you build it for me. So commerce comes out of this, and business comes out of it just from sharing those innovations. But initially, the user themselves, they're not trying to get the kayak company to buy their modified kayak. They're using it themselves and benefiting from it. These are Model Ts that have been modified. You know, one for farm work, the other for snow, and the other as a portable chapel. And I think, you know, the interesting thing, things change by the way they're used. And this is what we see in the software environment, and we see it in the hardware environment. People have their own ideas about how to use stuff. And it's, we really live in the era, I think, Christian, think about, you know, the first applications for the PC were built by Microsoft and Lotus 1-2-3. Today, we build more and more of our own applications. And the companies that are still around in software are the ones that are building, giving us tools to build applications. So, you know, here's another example. This is sort of LEDs on bicycle wheels. So a new form of night riding and making yourself, just in a practical sense, visible. So lastly, I just want to introduce a short video about Maker Faire. And this is an event, in doing the magazine, seeing all this stuff, especially in the Bay Area. I wanted to bring it together and just open it up to each other. So Maker Faire is coming up this year, May 30th and 31st in San Mateo. You know, we started it, this will be our fourth year. It started off the first year with 20,000 people. We went to about 40,000. Second year, last year, over 60,000 people. And, you know, it is, as John Schwartz wrote in the New York Times, it is a bit goofy and a bit grand. I mean, it's what individual people and small groups are doing. And it's art, it's science, it's technology. It blurs all those categories.